I don't know if you noticed during this week, but I think it was, I noticed it on Wednesday, but there was a crescent moon in the sky. I tried to take a picture of it to use, and then I found this public domain picture online that was much better than my attempt at it on my phone, so showed you that one instead. But there was a crescent moon, and the reason I show you a crescent moon is because every time I see one, I'm reminded of a line from the 90s kids movie, Angels in the Outfield. There's a little boy, and he sees a crescent moon, and he says, "Look, it's God's fingernail." And my brother would say that line every time he saw it. Now, it bothered me because I knew that's not God's fingernail. It's the shadow of the earth moving across the moon. That's not there. But at the same time, it stuck out to me when I thought about this message, because there's a reality that we can see God's finger, God's hand, his work in this world. And in the passage of Scripture today that we're going to look at, we'll see that line, the finger of God. But the question is, do we see God's work? Not in a crescent moon, that's not literally God's fingernail, but do we see God at work in our world, in our lives, and does that matter? Does that make a difference? What we do here when we gather is we open a passage of God's word and we go through it, book by book, chapter by chapter, and we're going through the book of Exodus, which is telling the story about how God is bringing his people, the Israelites, out of slavery into a relationship with him in his presence. It's an escape to God's presence. But the way he rescues them is he doesn't just pull them out right away, but he takes the opportunity to show his power, his finger, his hand, what he can do. And we're in a passage of Scripture known as the plagues, which are signs of judgment that God brings against the Egyptians who have his people in slavery. They're signs that show God's power and character. Now, in this section of Scripture, it's several chapters. There's a lot of repetition. There's Moses, who God is using, comes before Pharaoh, the leader of Egypt, and says, "Thus says the Lord, let my people go." Then there's some plague, and then ultimately at the end, the Pharaoh hardens his heart. So a lot of things are said over and over. So for today, we're kind of in the middle of these plagues, and I want to focus on what we learn about God's character and how we respond to his character. So today we're looking at Exodus chapter 8 and chapter 9. And in this passage, we're going to discover a God who has power. And this God uses his power to protect his people, as the song we just heard said, to hold them fast. And he does this because he has a purpose, which we'll look at. And because he does all this, he's a God of power who protects his people with a purpose. There's a response he expects of us. We can respond one of two ways to what he has done. We can either fear his word, honor what he has said and know him, or we can harden our hearts against him. My prayer is that we'll see his finger, his work, and that we will fear his word. We will come to know him. Now, Exodus 8 and 9 are two long chapters, and as we go through it, I'm not going to read every single verse, every single part. Most of the time, I'll have it up on the screen. I'm just kind of mostly going to talk about what's happening through it. If you have a Bible in front of you, you can follow along. And because it's a longer passage, I'm going to pray, and then we're going to look at it today. So let's pray. God, thank you for this morning. I pray you would focus our attention on your word. May we see your finger, your work, your power reflected in these verses, this passage of Scripture. May that power that we see lead us to also recognize what you use it for. You use it to protect your people, to look after your people. And you do that with a purpose, that people might know you. God, since you're doing all of that, I pray you would lead us to respond by fearing your word, by knowing you. Break through our hard hearts. Lead us away from hardening our heart against you, to instead seek to know you and to know you through a relationship with your Son, Jesus Christ. I pray as we see who you are, God, we would understand him better so that he may increase and that I may decrease. We may see Jesus and we may know him more. It's in his name, the name of Jesus, that I pray this morning. Amen. So these plagues make it very clear that in this passage of Scripture, we are dealing with a God of power, a God of power. And to look at that, I'm going to look at three of the plagues we'll read about in these chapters. First, we're going to pick up with a plague of frogs, what's often known as the second plague. It's 7 days after what we talked about last time. Moses came before Pharaoh, said, "Let my people go." Pharaoh said, "No." So God gave Moses power. He turned the water of the Nile River into blood. But it's 7 days after that, Moses reminds Pharaoh, "Hey, you're supposed to let the people go to serve and worship God." Chapter 8, verses 1 and 2, "The Lord said to Moses, 'Go into Pharaoh, say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. But if you refuse to let them go, behold, I will plague all your country with frogs.'" God is going to plague, smite Egypt with frogs. The whole land will swarm or teem with them. They'll come out of the river like a flood. Verses 3 and 4 say, "The Nile shall swarm with frogs that shall come up into your house and into your bedroom and on your bed and into the houses of your servants and your people, into your ovens and your kneading bowls. The frogs shall come up on you and on your people and on your servants." Why frogs? Well, God, we talked about last time, is showing his victory over the other gods of Egypt. And the Egyptians worshipped frogs because the Egyptians were obsessed with death. Pardon me. They were obsessed with death. They were obsessed with things that seemed to go between two worlds. And to them, these frogs are these incredible creatures. They live in the water and they live in the land. They can go between two worlds like we want to. In fact, their religion, their faith, often told them they're not allowed to kill frogs. And so God says, "You like frogs? Here they come." And there's going to be effects beyond a bloody river. They're coming into their homes everywhere, their personal space. It says they're on their bed, they're on their floor, in their ovens, they're on them. Now, on one hand, frogs by themselves they're not particularly scary creatures. They're not really harmful. But if they're everywhere or an unexpected place, that can be a little upsetting. The story popped in my mind about that. I sometimes, during the week, I'll stay one night and I'll work a little bit later to try to get ahead on the sermon or other work. And one night a couple years ago, I was here late. It was, I think, the middle of summer. But at night, the temperature cools down a little bit. And so I was at my office, and I always go out through the double doors that are right outside this sanctuary. And I pushed them open, and I'd been here late enough that the lights were off, so it was pretty dark out there. And I step my foot out, and all of a sudden there's this blob next to me that moves. And I jump. I almost hit my head on the door frame there. I was terrified of whatever this was. Pull my phone out. What in the world is here on the ground? It's this little toad sitting there just minding his own business. And I almost stepped on the poor guy. And so now, every evening, if I go out those doors at night, I am obsessively looking at that spot to make sure I'm not stepping on the frog. So it can be upsetting when a frog's in a place it's not supposed to be. So I can understand when there's frogs everywhere, how upsetting that would have been for the people of Egypt. And this is what happens. The frogs come. And if you were here last time, we talked about some magicians of Egypt, some priests that served Pharaoh, and they could also do some of these signs, and they do it again by their secret arts and enchantments. Verse 7, "But the magicians did the same by their secret arts. They made the frogs come up on the land of Egypt." And we talked last time, is this some power they have? Is it a trick? It really wouldn't be hard for them to do this trick if there's frogs everywhere. You just take a pile of them, put them in the river, and they'll probably hop out of the river out there. But the point is, the magicians, they can do something, but they're powerless to remove the frogs. And Pharaoh actually starts to understand this. He understands, my magicians can't help, but this Moses who I'm speaking to, his God who brought this plague, can take it away. So in verse 8, Pharaoh called Moses and Aaron and said, "Plead with the Lord to take away the frogs from me and from my people, and I will let the people go to sacrifice to the Lord." He's admitting that he's not in control. And Moses wants to make it clear to him, "Well, I'll show you who's in control, Pharaoh. It's God who's in control. So if you tell me, Pharaoh, when you want the frogs to go away, I'll tell God, and that's what will happen." Verses 9 and 10, Moses said, "Be pleased to command me when I am to plead for you, your servants and your people, that the frogs be cut off from your house." In verse 10, Pharaoh said, "Tomorrow." And Moses said, "Be it as you say, so that you may know that there is no one like the Lord our God. Perhaps Pharaoh thought he was asking the impossible. He's like, there's no way all these frogs are going to be dead in one day. But God likes doing impossible things, and he likes proving himself that he is the one who has the power. He controlled the frogs when they lived, when they died. The story is about him. Again, when we talk about Exodus, sometimes we get wrapped into the people. They're in slavery, and then they're going to come out. It's about a story of freedom, but it's actually a story about God. If it was just a story about freedom, God would have brought them out right away. God says, I'm here. I'm rescuing you. Freedom's what most important. But to God, what's most important is showing who he is. And so he is working through this process, showing his power. He is the one who does the rescuing. He wants everyone to know, as Psalm 86 says, that there is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. Now Moses does what Pharaoh asked. He prays, and it happens just as he says. The very next day, the frogs die. Where the magicians were ineffective, God responds. Verse 13 of chapter 8 says, the Lord did according to the word of Moses. The frogs died out in the houses, the courtyards, the fields. They gathered them together in heaps, and the land stank from all the dead frogs. But when Pharaoh saw there was a respite, he hardened his heart. He would not listen to them, as the Lord had said. He stubbornly hardens his heart while his people suffer. And so that brings us to the next plague, or the third one, which is a plague of gnats, which maybe gnats, it could be lice or bugs, biting insects. Some scholars think it's talking about a swarm of mosquitoes. But whatever it is, they're on all the animals and beasts. Verse 16, Lord says to Moses, to say to Aaron, stretch out your staff, strike the dust of the earth, that it may become gnats in all the land of Egypt. And they did so. Aaron stretched out his hand, struck the dust. There were gnats on man and on beast. There are gnats everywhere, or mosquitoes, whatever it is. And remember, this is 3,000 years ago. They didn't have screen doors then. And this is a hot climate, so they wouldn't have windows. They wouldn't have doors. They would keep everything open so the breeze could come through. And that brought all of these bugs in. They couldn't stop them. And this time, something different happens. These magicians who have been trying so hard to show that they could do the same thing, they're unable to do this because it's really hard to control mosquitoes. And the magicians tried by their secret arts to produce the gnats, the mosquitoes, whatever they were, but they could not. So there were gnats on man and on beast. And then here's what I named the message after. The magician said to Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. But Pharaoh, his heart was hardened. He would not listen to them, as the Lord had said. These magicians had been humiliated by God. The Egyptian priests weren't even supposed to touch bugs, but there's all of these bugs everywhere. They admit it can only come from a divine source that they call the finger of God. They admit he is the one who has power. They're experiencing it as judgment, but God's people experience the good of it. Psalm 8 says, when I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars that you've set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? God cares for his people, and the magicians realize that. We don't have power here. This God has the power. You think that'd be it for the magicians, but they actually show up one more time for good measure. So we're going to skip ahead a little bit to chapter 9, verses 8 through 12. Which is actually the sixth plague. So we're jumping from 3 to 6, and we'll come back. But I'm jumping to here because we'll see these magicians. Let me just read verses 8 and 9 to start. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, take handfuls of soot from the kiln. Let Moses throw them in the air in the sight of Pharaoh. It shall become a fine dust over all the land of Egypt and become boils breaking out on the sores of man and beast throughout the land of Egypt. So this time it's boils on the skin, perhaps skin sores, maybe some type of anthrax. And to start it, they take soot from a kiln, which maybe that's God's justice. Because if you remember, the Israelites made bricks as part of their slavery. And so they would have used these kilns. So this instrument of their slavery, God uses to bring judgment. And now the judgment's impacting the people of Egypt. They get these itchy, painful sores. We want to read what it was like. The book of Job talks about something like this. It Talks about Satan striking Job. God allowed him to do that with loathsome sores from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. And what Job does is he takes a piece of broken pottery and he scrapes himself while he sits in ashes. I imagine the Egyptians were going through the same thing. The plagues have progressed. The Lord is showing more and more of his power. Here he's showing he controls even people's health. There's wonderful medical professionals in the world, but God is the one who has the true power, who heals and makes well. So let me make it clear. You should follow the recommendations of your health professionals, absolutely, but you could follow them all, and God could still take you home. He is the one who is in control. And here's why I read this again, because we see God's power with our magician friends again in verses 10 and 11. They're so overcome by this, they can't even stand anymore. Verse 10 says, they do this, they take the soot, they throw it in the air, it becomes the sores. Verse 11, the magicians could not stand before Moses because of the boils. For the boils came upon the magicians and upon all the Egyptians. And this is the last time we hear of them. God has won this battle against these false prophets, priests, these magicians. They, at this point, they couldn't do it back with the gnats, the mosquitoes, and now they're completely overcome and defeated. God has conquered them. He has shown his power. Like one scholar, Terence Fred Imey, says, enter the magicians one last time. They have moved from an active to a passive stance, from sign workers to victim. They can no longer stand alongside Moses. They can only slink away, and they exit off the stage. This is the victory God has against those who attempt to compete with him. So here we've seen some of God's power here. He controls elements of nature. He controls these frogs and these bugs. He can control even the weather, we'll see later. But he also is over our health, over our own lives. He is the one who has the power. The question is, do we acknowledge that? That he can control these things. Everything we see in nature, our own bodies, our own life, do we acknowledge he is in control? Because what happens is not random, but part of his loving care. And that's what we'll see in the two plagues we skipped over. We'll see that this is not only a God of power, but a God who protects his people. A God who protects his people. And it's demonstrated in this plagues because from the plagues here on out, God will make it clear there's a distinction between what's going to happen to the Egyptians who are holding them in slavery and what happens to his people. There's a difference, a distinction. So back in chapter 8, starting in verse 20, we have this fourth plague, which is a plague of flies. Maybe it was scarabs or other swarming insects. Verse 20 says, Lord said to Moses, rise up early in the morning, present yourself to Pharaoh as he goes to the water. Say to him, let my people go, that they may serve me. Or else if you will not let my people go, behold, I will send swarms of flies on you, on your servants, on your people, into your houses. The houses of the Egyptians shall be filled with swarms of flies and also on the ground in which they stand. And I have to be honest, this may have been, of the plagues we read, the one that may have bothered me the most, because I don't like these little bugs and insects. My wife is very different. She grew up on a farm, and so she tells me we had flies all the time in our house. Said they'd put out fly paper, and after an hour, it would be covered with flies. They had to throw it out, get a new one. They were used to it. Pastor John hates flies. Okay. the Egyptians, however, they worshipped flies. And again, they're obsessed with death, and to them, flies were also a kind of magical creature because from their perspective, something would die, and then all of a sudden, flies would appear on it. It was life coming from something that was dead. Thank you, Dallas, very much. It was something coming from what was dead, but they needed to learn that God was the source of life. And in the passage there, I want you to note how God starts to talk about people, because that's what we're focusing on, that he protects his people. He says, back in verse 20, he says, let my people go, because these swarms of flies are going to come on your people. He's going to protect his people against those who are opposed to him. He makes this clear in chapter 8, verse 22. He then says, on that day, I'm going to set apart, I'm going to deal differently with this place called Goshen, which is where my people dwell. This one neighborhood of Egypt is not going to have these swarms of flies. And the reason why is so that you may know that I am the Lord. This is not natural. If there's flies everywhere, why would they avoid this one neighborhood? They can't read street signs. Why are they avoiding this? Because God is protecting his people. He's creating a safe haven for them. The reason why is so that Pharaoh and everyone would learn that he is the Lord. God is the Lord. He is the great I am guarding his people. He acts for those who know him. He'll say in the book of Malachi of his people this. He says of his people, they shall be mine, says the Lord of hosts. In the day when I make up my treasured possession, I will spare them as a man spares his son who serves him. Once more you shall see the distinction between the righteous and the wicked, between the one who serves God and the one who does not serve him. Or as our text puts it, he is going to put a division, a distinction between my people and your people, the people of Egypt. One scholar fleshes out why this is important, because the Egyptian gods aren't like this. They worship these deities that they see in the nature and world around them. Leon Cass says that God's power is totally unlike the power of these nature gods, which do not speak. They do not make distinctions. Unlike the biggest natural powers, things like hurricanes, earthquakes, floods, what the Greeks would call the god Poseidon, this god, the one true god, he can selectively avoid harming his favorites. He can act in a way that treats people differently based on how they know him. God is just, but he blesses his family. And we may say that seems unfair, but we do the same thing. If we have a family member, somebody we love and care about, we'll treat them differently than we will just any other person. And he brings his people peace in the midst of judgment. And I reflected on that there's swarms of flies going among the Egyptians. They probably can't even sit. They can't even eat. There's just flies everywhere. But for his people, it's calm. It's a normal day where they live. And that reminded me of the peace that God provides for those who know him. Yesterday, we had a funeral here at the church for one of our church members who recently passed, Jasper Marshalek. And his family reflected on that he was a peaceful man. I have to agree with that. He had a very peaceful, calm demeanor. And I shared with people then that God is the one who provides that source of peace. And we read this verse earlier, that the effect of righteousness, if we know God and have his righteousness, the result will be peace. The result of righteousness before God is quietness and trust forever. He says, my people will abide in a peaceful habitation, in secure dwellings, in a quiet resting place. His people know peace. They have the quiet rest of trust in a relationship with God. That doesn't mean that life is never hard. That doesn't mean life is never crazy. But his people have peace before him, true peace. I'm skipping ahead a little bit for those there. To verse 25, Pharaoh's going to try to bargain with God. He says, okay, fine, you can go sacrifice, but within this land. But Moses points out a couple of problems with that in the next two verses. He says, the Egyptians find us an abomination. They wouldn't like it if we sacrificed. But the more important thing he points out in verse 27 is that we must go 3 days' journey. We must go out into the wilderness and sacrifice as the Lord our God has told us. We are his people. We must do as he says. And Pharaoh says, okay, you can do that, but don't go far. Please hurry up and pray for me. That's what he suggests in verse 28. He's starting to get worn down. Moses warns him, don't cheat or lie against God again, and he prays, but again, Pharaoh hardens his heart one more time. And we're going to see this distinction one more time. This is in chapter 9 now. I'm going quickly through it. I apologize to the PowerPoint people back there. So in chapter 9 now, the plague is going to come on the animals of Egypt. He's saying it's foolish to try to resist what God is doing. But here we have more than a finger at work. Look at this, verse 2 and 3 of chapter 9. Moses said, if you refuse to let the people go, if you still hold them, behold, the hand of the Lord will fall with a severe plague upon your livestock and the livestock that are in the field. The horses, donkeys, camels, herds. and flocks. This time, God is bringing his hand of judgment on the Egyptians. He said that he would have to do this. Back in chapter 3, he said, I know the king of Egypt will not let you go unless he is compelled by a mighty hand. It's chapter 3, verse 19. So this time, it's the Egyptians' animals are dying. But again, God's going to make a difference here. The Egyptians worshipped their animals. They provided everything that they needed for them. But these objects of faith are going to be taken away. Their livestock is going to die. Maybe it's some type of animal disease or a pestilence, but it would have been devastating because animals were expensive and important for the people. But God again makes a distinction. This is chapter 9, verse 4. The Lord will make a distinction between the livestock of Israel, the livestock of Egypt, that nothing of all that belongs to the people of Israel shall die. He's saying there's going to be a difference of what happens to you Egyptians and to my people. God is in control, and what happens is just what he says. The animals die. The vast majority of them die. In verse 7, Pharaoh checks it out. He's seeing, did this actually happen? It says he sent, and behold, not one of the livestock of Israel was dead, but his animals were, and that upset him. He hardened his heart even more. This is what we see over and over through these plagues from here on out. God does something different with his people. Now, I don't want you to mishear this. What I'm not saying, and I've heard from preachers who call themselves prosperity preachers, is if you know God, then everything will go well in your life. It will all be wonderful and everything will be great. That's not what he's conveying here. He's saying that God does show special grace and mercy to his people. And he does so not because they're good or special, but to show his power. Not to make your life better, but he takes care of his people. This is building up to the very last plague, the 10th one, when God's angel of death will pass over his people to kill the firstborn of the Egyptians. And God does the same today. He protects his people from God's wrath. He cares for his people. He defends them. And so the question is, what fate do we want? Do we want to be separated from him in that judgment, or do we want to be a part of his people and his family? Because that is how we know peace. Again, that doesn't mean your life is not hard, but it means that our life is defined by resting in God. And we can rest in him because he has a purpose for us. Next section of verses, we're going to talk about one last plague today, which is the 7th one, where he talks about the purpose he has for what he is doing. God has a goal in what he's been doing through all this. The goal is to show his power and so people would know who he is. He says plagues are now going to come on Pharaoh's heart because he thought he had the power, but there's going to be one true Lord of the earth. Verse 14, he says, this time I will send all the plagues on you yourself, on your servants and your people, so that you may know there is none like me in all the earth. And God talks about how he's going to do this. Unlike all the other gods that were distant and multiple gods, this one did this one did that. Unlike today where everybody can do whatever they want, God says, no, there's one God who does what he wants. And he says, by now I could have put out my hand. In verse 15, I could have struck you and your people with pestilence. I could have cut you off from the work. From the earth. At any moment, God says, I could have dealt with you and finished this all right now. It's only his mercy that stopped this. But he says, I had a bigger purpose in mind. And look at verse 16. He reveals his purpose to Pharaoh. For this purpose, I have raised you up, Pharaoh, to show you my power and so that my name may be proclaimed in all the earth. We're not 100% sure exactly which Pharaoh this was. There's different debates. But whoever he was, God's saying, I raised up this man to rule at this time, right now, to have this type of hard heart so that I could show my power, that people might know who I am. He is absolutely sovereign and in control. The Apostle Paul would quote this verse in the book of Romans to show God has power. I don't have it on the screen because it's just that verse. He says, this is the power God has. But it's similar to what the book of Proverbs says. Proverbs 16 says, "The Lord has made everything for its purpose, even the wicked for the day of trouble. Everyone who is arrogant in heart is an abomination to the Lord, and be assured he will not go unpunished." God has made everything for a purpose. But there's a note of hope in there. Verse 6 says, "By steadfast love and faithfulness, our iniquity or sin is atoned for. It's by the fear of the Lord that one turns away from evil." This is the hope that God provides there. Is yes, he's made everything for a purpose. There's judgment to come, but there is steadfast love and hope. There are those who can be saved by an atoning work. For those of us who are believers, we know what that work is. It's Jesus dying for us. Our sin pushed us away from God, but Jesus died on our behalf so that we could experience that steadfast love and faithfulness of God, that we would not be subject to his wrath. Jesus died so that we would know God. This Pharaoh, though, in our text, he doesn't get it. He's still exalting himself against God's people. He will not let them go. He refuses to see that every part of his life is a part of God's purpose. He's too proud. He's probably offended by the idea. And it is a little offensive. I'm telling you that your life serves God's purpose. The reason you exist is God has a grand purpose about how you fit in to what he is doing. That kind of goes against the mentality of our day, that you pick your own destiny, you do what you want. No, God has a larger purpose. And the good thing about that is that means all the events in your life serve that purpose. Everything that happens to you or to someone else is God showing who he is. It's not random. Sometimes we can't see it in the moment. Sometimes it's really hard and difficult and painful. Sometimes we may not see it for years. Sometimes we may not see it on this side of heaven. But are you getting the message? God has a purpose for you. And part of that purpose, part of what he sets forward, is an opportunity for us to know him. We've been separated by our sin, but we can know him, be restored and saved through faith and trust in his son. And that brings me to the last thing I want to highlight today, which is, how will you respond to this God? In this seventh plague we're about to look at, it's a plague of hail and storm. We're going to see two responses people have when God tells them what's going to happen. People are going to respond two different ways. The one way they'll respond is by fearing his word, respecting, trusting God's word, what he says. In verses 18 and 19, God promises that in chapter 9, there's going to be the worst hailstorm or thunderstorm in Egypt's history. He says, "Behold, about this time tomorrow, I will cause very heavy hail to fall, such as never been in Egypt from the day it was founded until now. So send, get your livestock, all that you have in the field, into safe shelter. Every man and beast that is in the field and not brought home will die when the hail falls." God says, there's a judgment coming, but there is a way to escape it. There's a way out for those of you willing to take it. And some, unlike Pharaoh, some Egyptians are starting to get this and understand who this God is. Look at verse 20. It says, "Then whoever feared the word of the Lord among the servants of Pharaoh hurried his slaves and his livestock into their houses." Some get it, but some choose to ignore it and disregard it. Verse 21, "Whoever did not pay attention to the word of the Lord left his slaves, his servants, and his livestock out in the field." Maybe their logic is, so what? Maybe there won't be a hailstorm. Even if there is, hailstorms are short. They're normally not that bad. Everything will be fine. But we're seeing God's word lived out here. Proverbs 13 says, "Whoever despises the word brings destruction on himself, but the one who reveres it will be rewarded." Some did fear and respond. They're probably not saved, I would call that, but Proverbs says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge and wisdom. God's presenting an opportunity to the Egyptians here. He's saying, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. There's a way for you to be safe, and that's by respecting, fearing what I say. Later, there'll be actually be Egyptians who join the Israelites when they leave. This is the hope that we have. If we see God's power, we can fear and respect him. But there's another response. I'm going ahead to the other response, is to harden your heart. Is to harden your heart. Some didn't listen, and the plague comes. Thunder, hail, fire, and lightning. Verses 22 and 23, the Lord stretches out to heaven. There is hail in the land of Egypt, on man and beast, every plant in the field. Moses stretched out his staff. The Lord sent thunder, hail, fire, probably lightning, ran down on earth. The Lord rained hail down on the land of Egypt. The one true God is speaking and acting. Psalm 78 said, he destroyed their vines with hail, their sycamores with frost. He gave their cattle to the hail, their flocks to the thunderbolts. He controls what is happening, and he struck down every person or animal and plant that was out in the field. Verse 24 speaks about the hail, the fire flashing continually, very heavy, as never been in all the land of Egypt. Verse 25, the hail struck down everything that was in the field, both man and beast, every plant of the field, broke every tree in the field. This is a terrible hailstorm. Now, around here, we don't really have terrible, terrible hailstorms. It's more, every so often, there's like the little stuff that falls. Last year, I think there was a storm, like some roofs were damaged by it, but hail can be very deadly. In some of my research came across, in 1888, there were 240 people killed by a hailstorm in India. As recently as 1984, 400 people, some killed, a lot injured in Germany. In 2002, 22 killed, 200 injured in China. Hail can be devastating. But once again, it doesn't happen everywhere. If you look at the very bottom, only the land of Goshen, where the people of Israel were, God kept them safe. There was no hail. And so finally, let's see Pharaoh's response to this. He starts saying what sounds like the right thing, but he doesn't quite get what's happening here. He says in verse 27, this time I have sinned. The Lord is right. I and my people are in the wrong. But he starts to get at heart here. He says, plead with the Lord. There has been enough of God's thunder and hail. I will let you go. You shall stay no longer. But he just wants the pain to stop in the moment. He has words saying, I'm following God, but he doesn't have the heart. One pastor, Tony Marita, says there's a difference between remorse and repentance. Repentance is turning away from sin. Moses will then go out, he'll pray, the hail will stop, but this time he's learned that Pharaoh's words aren't genuine. If you look then at verse 30, Moses said, as for you and your servants, I know that you do not yet fear the Lord. In chapter 9, verse 30, he knows that their heart isn't there. Pharaoh probably thought, there's going to be other crops later, we'll be fine. And as soon as it's over, verse 34, when Pharaoh saw the rain, hail, and thunder had ceased, he sinned yet again and hardened his heart, he and his servants. The heart of Pharaoh was hardened. He did not let the people of Israel go, just as the Lord had spoken to Moses. The removal of this pain exposed his lack of repentance. Another pastor, Jay Schuyler, said, repentance that evaporates once discipline ends is not genuine. He sees his heart wasn't actually in that change. He had hardened his heart against God. And this is the choice that's presented before us. Later generations will learn from this. I actually read this. I read through the Bible in a year. I'm not saying that as a brag. It's a discipline that I've had for the past 10 years or so. And right now I'm in 1 Samuel and just read this. These are the Philistines, enemies of God. But they've heard this story and they realize there's something God wants them to do. And they say to one another, why should we harden our hearts as the Egyptians and Pharaoh hardened their hearts? Because after God dealt severely with them, they sent the people away. It didn't matter. They had these hard hearts, and God still did what he was going to do. So this is the choice that's before us. We see there's this God of power. If we're willing to look and recognize it, not in a crescent moon, but in the fact that he's a God who acts, that he's a God in control and with a purpose, that what we see around us is from him, that our own health is in his hand, whether we're sick or we get well, he is the one who is in charge. And this God does something for his people, those who know him. It spoke here in this word, he takes care of them. Maybe things are hard, maybe they suffer, they could even die, but he still takes care of them in this life and the next. And so when he acts, he has a purpose. It's a purpose that people would know him. But how do we respond to that? Do we respond to that by, like Pharaoh, hardening our heart against him? Well, that's foolish. It won't work. We'll get there very soon. The people do leave. They actually have an exodus. That's the name of the book. The name of the book's a spoiler. They're going to leave the land. Pharaoh's resistance will not work. Or we're going to be like those Egyptians who learned, who feared the word of the Lord, said, no, there's something to this God. And perhaps some of them are beginning a journey of knowing him. God is a God of power, but he protects people according to his purpose. We either harden ourselves against him and suffer, or we fear him and worship him because he alone is worthy.